One of the best practices is to pray open-endedly for the grace to do whatever it wants to. No parameters set, no boundaries, no edges, no expectations. Whatever it is, I'm willing to experience it. Very powerful. It's very abstract. And this is what I did this morning. I said, okay, I'll accept a miracle from Longchenpa, which is emanation of the grace of God, really. But I'm not saying what it has to be at all. Whatever it is, I'll accept it. This puts you in a very good frame of mind to go forward. It takes a lot of discipline to do this. So, and also pray that whatever you have is given to everyone. Pray for everyone. Put a ring around on everyone's finger, as it were. We all have the same mind, the one mind, the beautiful wish-fulfilling gem of a mind. That's our true nature. Now, a lot of clarification and progress has been made. It's May 14th. We're really getting down to the nitty-gritty, the end of the road, as it were, end of this rocky road, and a start of a much smoother road is ahead for us. To say, and it's the opposite for the world. The world is about to go on a very rocky road, and we're about to go on a very smooth road. It's just at this time there's some tension there around this issue, because the world is, you know that there's going to be regrets and attempt to turn things upside down on us. There's no question that is the case. So, we will be protected, and we just accept this. It's not easy. But I can explain better now. If you can hear it, if you're willing to hear this, just hear it. Okay, always practice in the wow. Hear in the wow. This is how I've been able to get to this information. I hear stuff and it's just like, wow, that's true. Oh wow. It's like that. Instead of thinking now, okay, think. Let me think about this. No, just quiet listening, hearing. Wow. This is true. And you let it settle in. You receive it. You take it in your hand. You take it in. You take it in this way. This is the key. You have to take it in the right way, like this. Don't say, who are you? You know, what do you want? Interrogate it. Say, oh wow, you I have a wonderful visitor. Come on in. Sit down. And then you sit down and just quietly just say, wow. I have this awesome visitor has come. This awesome information has arrived for me. This is tremendous. It's like that. So we welcome this great information and not interrogate it. The truth is that there is no such thing as matter. Matter does not exist. It has never existed. There's not even one speck of matter, for an instant, has ever existed. Matter doesn't exist. Matter is the belief that reality can be scripted. In other words, that we can change reality. It's simply wishful thinking on our part. There is no matter whatsoever. So this is a big wow to hear this. You don't often hear this said. Now, what we've done is a very clever marketing trick on ourselves, and that we've divided matter into pure matter and impure matter. We've divided what doesn't exist into pure matter, virgin matter, and non-virginal matter, pure matter and impure matter. And what we claim is we're trying to purify matter. There's some matter that needs to be purified. The fact is there isn't any matter at all. But by making this dualistic trap for our minds, you see, this is what we've done. Virgin matter. Doesn't exist. Neither does impure matter. Neither impure matter nor pure matter exist at all. So duality is this effort to purify, which is totally delusional. There is no matter to purify at all. The symbol for pure matter, immaculate matter, symbolizes the goddess in Christianity. It became the cult of the Virgin Mary, which was really the pagans of Europe. Simply, they always worshipped a mother goddess, warrior goddess, to help them in conquest, death, destruction, mayhem, conquest. It was a goddess. And they just adopted the Virgin Mary as their warrior goddess to go to battle under, saying that she would, you know, defeat the enemy for you, throw dirt in their eyes and to confuse them and enable us to destroy them. But this cult arose of, you know, Virgin Mary, Immaculate Mother, the Immaculate Matter, Mater, Immaculate Mater, Virgin Mater, Matter. And that they were protecting this virgin matter from the impure matter, the infidels, the heathen, you know, the pagan. So they go conquer, say, we're protecting this virgin matter. Well, this is the root of evil, of wickedness, of delusion. That is right. This is what I'm saying. The Virgin Mary, really, the way that it has nothing to do with the mother, with the wife of Joseph, or the mother of Jesus. Nothing to do whatsoever with it. This is a pagan warrior goddess, dualistic matter belief. Okay, it's the heart of wickedness and deception. The very root, the deepest root. And we feel afraid to even go there because we say, well, but that's pure matter. We like pure matter. No, pure matter is a marketing scheme to get us to believe in matter, which is scriptedness, which doesn't exist in reality. Reality is completely free. So we've had a very difficult time with this issue. I have. Everyone does. We're seeing through it now. It's like, oh, wait a minute. Hey, wait a minute. And it's really interesting. I came across this picture of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. And I said, I hadn't seen that picture before. What is this? I have it on my computer. I downloaded it, but I hadn't really noticed it. And it said that there was this quote saying, you must go beyond good consciousness and bad consciousness. Leave those both behind and realize that the absolute saturation of isness. And I said, wow. I mean, that's just an awesome quote. Good consciousness, bad consciousness. Pure matter, impure matter. This is exactly what you're saying. And it just struck a chord in me. It said, oh, thank you very much. Because this is what we're struggling with, actually. And so for a female Nirmanakaya body here in this world, a divine body, the divine emanation of grace show up as a female body, and to say you must go beyond both, you know, pure matter and impure matter to the isness. Very powerful, right? So, this leaves the Virgin Mary cult behind, the Virgin Matter cult behind. And it's a cult, and it's the world cult of believing in matter. And that we can purify matter, we're supposed to purify matter. And I was in abundance in truth once, and I eventually got dislodged from it. I sort of thought that maybe I'm not there, you know, or I shouldn't be there or something. And it had to do with these warriors of light, these light workers, light warriors, who are making this big effort to conquest, to purify this impure area of consciousness. We had to purify this. So they're on this holy light crusade, you know. And it seemed like, wow, maybe this is where it's at. I didn't know how to deal with that. But so this is the root. This is the key, which makes us unaware of our abidance in the isness, unscripted isness of the now. Is this pure matter working to purify impure matter? This is again a marketing scheme that we have used to deceive ourselves. There is no matter at all. So how can we even, there's no impure matter to purify. And there's no pure matter to do the purification at all. Reality is completely unscripted. There's no two moments that are bound together. Matter would be, there's, structure and form. There's no form in reality. There's no structure or form or script at all. Everything arises spontaneously in the now, meaning instantly, immediately, without any trace of any other instant. That's why we say reality is traceless and baseless. There's no matter. Matter doesn't exist. We're just dreaming it. We're just dreaming it. And so, really, there's this goddess cult in the world. In fact, we're all have been goddess cultus, meaning believing in pure matter and impure matter, and feeling that our crusade is to purify matter. Get rid of the impure, purify it. This is the heart of self-deception, the heart of delusion, the very deepest root of our delusion. And of course, we market it as if the Immaculate Virgin. You know, how can we be against that? Well, we're absolutely against it because it's a belief in something that doesn't exist. We're serving that which is doesn't even exist. We're on a holy crusade against impure matter, and it doesn't even exist. So this keeps us deluded from realizing what does exist. So that's the heart of wickedness. It's the heart of self-deception, actually. And it's been the toughest root of all to uncover. How dare anybody go against the Virgin Mary? But again, this was something that is just a warrior goddess cult. If you look at history, how it developed. I mean, it also came from Isis from Egypt, but it had nothing to do with the real Mary, mother of Jesus, wife of Joseph. Absolutely nothing to do with it, actually. And, they made all these extravagant claims for their warrior goddess, which is just an egoic projection. And they built up this cult, of a fourth aspect of the Trinity. And all it's a matter cult, okay? It's a matter cult, belief in matter, okay? This is the cult that we have been trapped in, is the belief in matter, nature. Matter, it doesn't exist. Now again, don't think about this, because it's not something that's thinkable, because thinking is based on the belief in matter. Okay? Thinking is based on the belief in matter. So as soon as you start engaging all your thinking, you're undermining what's being said. This is why it's difficult to get to this, because you think, well, I need to really think about this. As soon as you do that, you're being pulled into the cult of matter. And then it seems like heresy to say this, right? So you have to be very skilled in full stop in the wow of not thinking, but knowing and recognizing. So that it does, you don't dissipate it. It's like abidance. You cannot think about abidance. That dissipates the awareness. Or at least it's ignoring it. Builds up this fog, like fogs our mind, as it were. The abidance is still there, but we don't recognize it. Our attention is on a crusade, holy crusade. There is no holy crusade. There's nothing to crusade against, actually. There's no crusaders and nothing to crusade against. What we do here is we set an example of this fact. So my job is to set an example. Those of you who are doing this, set an example. I try to set the best example I can. Nobody's paid attention, really, especially those that I meet, and nobody seems to pay any attention. So it's difficult to keep setting example. They just ignore it because they're focused on, you know, matter. What do we do about matter? How do we have, you know, happy matter, good matter, pure matter, immaculate matter, untouched matter? This is utter blasphemy. You know, it's an attempt to destroy God, the belief in matter. Even the belief in pure, in fact, especially the belief in pure matter, is an attempt to deny God. That's all it is. The real Virgin Mary, remember in the wedding at Cana, the servants asked her, you know, what should we do? I mean, she said, do whatever Jesus tells you to do. That's it. And that's pretty much, you know, pretty much it, right? I mean, that's it. She wasn't some warrior goddess riding a white steed and a flaming sword, directing massacres in battle for pagans. That this is just crazy, absolutely insane. It's a cult, a matter cult. This whole thing about, you know, the church militant crusaders, you know, that the James and the Virgin Mary are helping, you know, conquer the world for Christianity stuff. No, this is a pagan matter cult. It's an insane matter cult. It's extreme dualism. And again, just hear this and just say, wow. I didn't expect to hear this. So it seems that those who follow this cult, they're very pure. They try to be very pure. They're very, you know, very, you know, to serve the Virgin Mary, very, very pure. But they're on a crusade to purify impure matter, which is the belief in matter. And matter has never existed at all. And in fact, again, the belief in matter is the belief in a desire to destroy God, plain and simple. As Jesus said, it's an attempt to attack God, attack and destroy God. So this crusade of purifying matter is really a crusade to try and attack and destroy God. Because there's no matter in reality at all. There's only the instantaneous, spontaneous service of the living light to spirit, the will of God, that simply whatever we order, that's what is. That's what is. And the pure potentiality of God is always omnipresent. Whatever we choose to experience, instantly, it is. It is. It is. No precursor and no follower. No subsequentness. I don't know, is it precursor? It should be pre and post. No postcursor. No precursor. No postcursor. No trace. Traceless. Baseless. Reality. This is reality. This is God. So in our attempt to conquer God, we have marketed it as a crusade of the pure matter against impure matter. Sounds like dualism, doesn't it? Yeah. Sounds like Gnosticism also, doesn't it? Yeah. Sounds like pagan warrior cultism, yes. All this stuff. I mean, it sounds like duality, and it is duality, which is the heart of delusion. And yet they wrap it up in the cloak of sanctity, saying the Mother of God is, you know, is the one who is sponsoring this. So how dare you? God doesn't have any mother. Prime Creator is just the immediate isness. There's no precursor to the experiencing of God. And no postcursor at all. So there's no mother to it at all, either pre or post. It's all just the isness. And this came from Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, who many people insisted she's the mother. You know, she said, no, I'm not the mother. She rejected, entirely rejected the notion of mother. Except this, the principle of a supportive role, being supportive of our spiritual path, like a mother supports the child. She said, okay, you know, if you want to see it that way. But she really said, see me as a friend. Or as your daughter, little daughter, if your house or little daughter, see me as a little daughter, or a sibling, like a sister, or even better, like a friend, but not the mother. No, there's no mother to reality. There's no mother to reality. Reality is right now. A mother means there's a precursor to nowness. There's no mother to it. That would produce matter. And the idea is mother produces matter. Okay, it's the belief in matter. There's no matter in reality. And this belief in matter ceaselessly believes in conquest, crusades and conquest. Ceaselessly. Conquest, conquest, conquest. History of the world, right? And they ride into battle under the banner of the pure mother, the pure virgin matter, mater. They say, this is, you know, this is our crusade. This is what we stand for. We're righteous. This is what God supports. We're on a crusade to destroy impure matter and to evangelize it so it becomes pure matter. Again, this is the game we've been playing, which is totally delusional. And it's really, again, our belief that we can attack and destroy God by believing in matter. But we say, oh, no, we believe in pure matter. Well, what does pure matter mean? What do you mean with pure matter? Yeah, we believe in pure duality. We believe in precursorness. The precursor, to reality is very pure. It's totally pure. It's like saying that there's a something preceding pure spaciousness that's even purer. You know, this is an attempt to usurp prime creatorness from God, plain and simple. And you get into the issue, too, it bifurcates in various ways. One of the main ways is the idea that women are purer than men, and they're on a crusade to purify men, that men represent impure matter. And sometimes in the past, it's been the opposite way, that women have represented impure matter. But anyway, you look at it, it's like Eve worship, I mean, a precursor to reality. There's no such thing. But right now, it's all about that men are impure matter. Women are represent pure matter, and they're on a crusade to purify men by scripting everything so they could be purified. This is, you know, a cult of duality, of severe wickedness and evil. Results in endless conquest and crusades and crushing the heathen, the impure matter. It's always being crushed. But, of course, there always has to be more impure matter, right? Because it never results in our satisfaction at all. We're only satisfied by the immediate, spontaneous isness of reality, no matter whatsoever. Only that satisfies us. So duality says, well, we're not happy. Well, there must be some impure matter somewhere we haven't yet to conquer. So we must continue to conquer that and script more and more and more scriptedness. Let's script pure matter here. So it's ceaseless effort and struggle. History of the world. History of this of madness, actually. Not the world. It's the history of madness. It's the history of arrogance and conceit. So, you know, it seems like the utmost blasphemy to say that the Virgin Mary is the heart of deceit. But it's true. It's absolutely true. Not the mother of Jesus and the wife of Joseph. No. She's probably a saint. But, again, the Virgin Mary that we have in the world has nothing to do with that. It's has everything to do with duality and the belief in matter. 100%. And the idea of I can, you know, it's an antichrist cult. It's a completely opposite of what Jesus is teaching, completely opposite. So instead of doing whatever Jesus tells you to do, which is what the real Mary, wife of Joseph, said, now we're told do whatever the Virgin Mary tells us to do, because she knows what Jesus really wants us to do. Really wants for us. It's just that we don't understand. So she's explaining what he really wants. So it's basically saying, don't do what Jesus says, do whatever the mother of Jesus says. Completely reversed, upside down and backwards. Now, this may be a bitter pill to swallow, but I didn't come to give placebos here. You know, this is real medicine. You have to take the medicine and just wow. Gradually you get used to this and you start waking up to reality. The absolutely blissful nature of reality, which is we realize this matter doesn't exist at all. Never has. Everything is just the emanation of this diamond mind in the now. Ornamentation of its own spaciousness. Everything is posing as matter. You know, a lot of what we see as a world, just pretending, it's a pose. It's not really matter at all. Because everything is everything. In other words, all potential is present everywhere, always. And in an instant, if we want to see a different ornamentation, that is so. Without any trace of a past or any presentiment of a future whatsoever. It's completely fresh and present. Absolutely present. And this is the experience of the Sambhogakaya, the bliss body, the Christ consciousness body, the inward vision of this is that it's absolutely present. Each moment, its presence doesn't waver or flicker or change. There's no past and no future to it whatsoever. And it's not trying to forget the past or forget the future. It doesn't exist. It's always in the moment, in the now, which is the only place there is the now. There is no other place. It's not crusading at all. Keep this in mind. There's no crusade. It's not crusading in the slightest bit. Our mind is not crusading. There's nothing to defeat or to destroy or purify whatsoever. Now we're dreaming a dream that to try and justify our desire to usurp God. But this dream is also just in the now. Even though we've taken great pains to make it seem otherwise, it still is. We're still completely free. There's still just freedom. Even though perceptually it doesn't seem that way. That's just an illusion. Jesus calls all this just a hallucination. But hallucinations are also in the now. Entirely. It doesn't matter what we're hallucinating. The hallucinating is in the now. There's no past to it and no future to it. So we can hallucinate a past and future, but that's still totally in the now. Our mind is still totally present. And this is fresh and untouched by any past or any future moment. Completely fresh. So our belief in time is still also completely fresh. It's not contaminated or impure at all. Our belief in impurity is still completely pure. In the now. And this is what we're waking up to. Some of you are waking up to this. I'm waking up to it also. It comes now, you see it and you say, wow, I got it. And then it tends to fade. And then you see it again and then it tends to fade. And then it'll come back again and stronger and more clearly. It's like that. So you just have to be patient, have faith in it, that it will. Try to force it. But this issue of pure and impure matter is very key to the whole abidance issue. We're pulled out of abidance by our intrigue about this crusade against impure matter. And this is how we get hooked out of abidance. At least the belief that somehow the belief in pure and impure is not in the now, that it has to be established in the now through something has to happen. This is delusion. Nothing has to happen. Nothing has ever happened, actually. Nothing ever will happen. Reality is not a happening. It's an isness. Now, I can't seem to lose weight. It's amazing. I keep starving myself. And I believe it must be that I'm building up muscle mass, which is heavier than fat, actually. It's heavier. And so this is why I'm not losing weight, which is a good thing. So I keep thinking, oh, I'm failing. Now, wait a minute. I wanted to build up some muscle mass. So I'm succeeding. And on the path, we might think we're failing. We may be succeeding. All right? It's very interesting here. Certainly, getting to what I'm getting to now is signs of tremendous success. And yet, I don't quite feel that way. If I look at the scale, I say, well, I'm not hitting my weight. I need to lose, more weight. But again, is that really the goal? Or is it to build up more muscle mass and strength? Interesting, right? Of course, I'd like to have the best of both worlds. But so maybe it's working. Like maybe this path is working better than we realize. Just because we're measuring it in a false way, we think, I have to have this abidance, but maybe we're looking at what is it that pulls us out of abidance, and becoming so clear about that and evaporating that, that just effortlessly we'll just go into abidance and stay there, you see. It's not the struggle to remain in abidance. That's not the answer. Don't struggle. This is what I realized when I was sort of pulled out of abidance, my attention got intrigued out of it. I accepted. I said, okay, full stop on the wow. Didn't struggle against it. And I realized this is the right approach. Be humble, be meek. The humble, meek approach is right on your path. Don't try to force it. Don't be a warrior, a conquistador. Okay. Abidance is not something we conquer. It's not a conquer. It's not a conquest. We're not conquistadores. So be humble and meek and full stop on the wow. Say, wow, that was a really intense experience. Wow. And then I've gone to work on saying, okay, let me go to work on what is intriguing me enough that I'm abandoning abidance, my awareness of it, you know, with my tension, and keep working on that. So I may not have an abidance as much as I'd like, but full abidance is on the horizon. It's dawning, right? I say this is really the goal. It's not how many times can I glimpse it, but can I get into full abidance? So it's not really what weight do I hit, low weight, but what's my actual strength? That's what's really important, your actual strength. And nimbleness and flexibility along with that. It's a combination, but the strength has to be there. So you don't want to starve yourself. You see, then you lose muscle mass and get weaker. So I keep, you know, eating protein and keep eating to build up muscle mass, muscle strength. And I know maybe that puts on weight. I say, okay, I have to abide by that. So we keep working on what is this that is intriguing us out of abidance in truth, in reality. And we keep looking at that. We keep looking at it. Oh, this crusade of purity. That's what does it. So we look at it, and there's all these crusaders with their smartphones. By the way, smartphones, you know, most people, I realize, every day, just realize that you have a smartphone. Every day, you're intensely engaged with it, basically, every single day. Well, guess what? I'm intensely not engaged with it every day. This is how I measure my day. Wow, I had a day of intense non-engagement with smartphones. I have intense non-engagement with smartphones every day. See, this puts a positive measurement on your life instead of a negative one. It's very helpful. This just occurred to me this morning. I said, I don't have a smartphone, and everybody is just so engaged. They're on a crusade. They're crusaders, actually. You have to understand, the smartphone is the modern weaponry of the modern crusade. It's the weaponry of the modern crusade to purify matter. That is the weapon. In the past, it was the swords and the mace and the armor. Today, it's the electronic gadgets. It's the smartphone, actually, that is the crusader's weapon of choice. And so I'm thinking, oh, I don't have a smartphone. I said, wait a minute. No, my discipline is I have this wonderful, intense non-engagement with smartphones. I'm doing very great with this intense non-engagement. So I have a day saturated with non-engagement with smartphones. So I'm putting in a positive light like this, you see? Now, I imagine everyone that views this has a smartphone. This is how ubiquitous it is. But I do meet, especially older people, who are very smart and aware, wise, and saying, wow, I don't want this engagement. I know that it's leading me into very bad habits, and I'm not going to do it. And they hold the line, but some are falling. They say, my grandchildren insisted that I get one, and they bought one for me. I say, what do I need this for? It's ridiculous, you know. This is how intense it is. The world's on this intense crusade now, and the crusade is going to get underway July 24th, 2016. There's this huge crusade. Keep in mind the history of this planet, the history of crusades in different ways, right? We know the Christian crusades, but there's been Islamic crusades. There's one going on right now. Massive crusade, right? And there's been crusades in all over the planet. Conquest, 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 conquest. The crusades. The Golden Horde, the Genghis Khan crusades and the Mongolian, crusades trying to conquer China and counter crusades and it goes on and on and on. They try to conquer Europe. Conquest. Duality is always engaged in conquest, whether it's the conquest of space, whether it's the extraterrestrials' conquest of this planet, which is what they have done, basically. But there's many crusades taking place, and the crusade of technology to script everything, the crusade of let's script everything even better than before, and then they'll be happy with scripting. That's just we haven't scripted good enough, and if we just script enough, if we just matter enough, then we'll be happy. We can say, no, we don't matter. I don't matter at all, because there is no matter. I is the belief in matter, actually. So there is no a me, there is no me, there is no I or me, there is no matter to what I am. I don't matter at all. I am. I don't say, I don't matter at all, I am. So I'm intensely engaged with not mattering. I have this beautiful, intense engagement with not mattering at all. Yeah, just like I have this intense non-engagement with smartphones. What a great day. I had this great non-engagement with smartphones. How about that? But if you have a smartphone, you're going to be engaged with it. This is the trouble. Almost everyone is, except some of the older people. They just have it. Say, I never use it. Lady told me, I never use it. I have it in my purse, but I never even look. I never even use it. But that's very rare. Very rare. And I dare say, if you have a smartphone, I would bet money on this, that you absolutely are not going to downgrade to a non-smartphone. Absolutely not going to do it. Just think about that and the horrors that arise in your mind. Get that like the shakes. And you go into AT&T and say, I want to upgrade my smartphone to a flip phone. I say, what do you mean upgrade? It's a downgrade. No, it's an upgrade because that'll help me be intensely non-engaged with the smartphone, which helps me realize I don't matter, I am, which helps me get free of the blasphemy of matter. So it's a super upgrade. So let me, I'm going to upgrade to a flip phone or just a BlackBerry or something. I want to upgrade. They're like, look at you like you're insane. But you're not. You have an intense engagement, an intense non-engagement with insanity. See? The insanity of the belief in matter. I have an intense non-engagement with insanity. So upgrade from your smartphone to a BlackBerry or flip phone. I like flip phones. Just like I like cats. Why? Come home, the cat's hungry, the cat shows up and says, "Oh, friend, how are you? I just love to see you're a wonderful person." And you say, "Oh, cat, you're a wonderful cat." And the cat just looks at you lovingly and peacefully and like, "Wow." What's the want? Wants food, of course. So you feed the cat, and then you got stuff to do. The cat disappears, it goes sleeps, and that's it. And the cat says, "Don't worry about me, I'm fine. Don't worry about me, I'm fine." So it's not begging for attention. It's not, it's not obsessive like a dog. A dog is way too obsessive. Dogs are cute and all this, and I've had a lot of dogs in my life, but I got really tired of them. And I can't take it anymore. They're way too, they just total demand your attention all the time. Cats, they're so kind and cool and when they want food, you're like you're their best friend. And then when they've got the food, leave me alone, I'm okay. I like that. I like that. They just take care of their own lives, I don't where they go, I don't know what they do, I don't know. But they just oftentimes are just sitting there just listening and just blissing out. A lot of some cats they just bliss out. I like that. The dogs are always like, are you going to take me for my walk? You know, do you love me? Are you going to say hello? Can I go outside and I do this? Or just let the cats out, or the house cat, and they're just like saying, oh, I'm just so perfectly happy. I'm so happy. I don't need anything. I'm just blessed out. Yeah. So I had a dream last night where my cat, my wonderful cat, I don't have a cat now, but a cat I had, I recognize it. Oh, I took it somewhere, and this very nasty lady has this small little nasty dog, and this nasty dog suddenly went chasing my cat, trying to kill it. And the cat ran around, was cornered the cat, and I said, uh-oh, it's going to kill the cat. Well, I went to rescue the cat, and actually the cat had flipped the script on the dog and was on, had the dog on its back in submissive, and was, you know, so the cat was stronger than the dog, actually. And I separated the two, and I took the cat and said, wow. You know, so the dog is out to kill the cat, and it's the feminine belief in matter is out to kill the realization there is no matter. The cat is just blissed out. What matter? You know, nothing matters to me. There's nothing to matter at all. And the last cat I had was that way. Is like, there's nothing the matter whatsoever. Everything is perfect right this instant. And the cat just abided in that. It was like a Sambhogakaya. It was like a Nirmanakaya cat, actually, with a Sambhogakaya body of bliss body. It had a bliss body. This cat had a bliss body. Now, when it's hungry, it came and said hello and blessings to you. Can you give me a little food? And I have to, you know, stay alive here. But other than that, then I have the food and then I'm fine. I'm in bliss. Just, it never lost the bliss. It just had to keep its body here. And there's nothing to matter. There's never anything to matter for that cat at all. Wherever it was just in bliss. It would lie here, and then the sun would move. It would go move with the sun a little bit here. And he'd see and say hello to it, and just kind of, it would like kind of open his eyes and just look at you and just say, I'm perfect. Yeah, how about you? Everything's perfect for me. How's it for you? And I just sit down next to the cat. I just look at it and say, wow, let me just get this vibe. So the cat says, I don't have any needs at all. You don't have to do anything for me. Everything's just absolutely perfect, just the way it is. So I would just pick up on this vibe, and it was just such a wonderful vibe. I was so sad when the cat left us, got sick, got cancer. But it comes in dreams now. It comes to me in dreams. And it showed me last night this vicious aggressiveness of the feminine, the dog nature of attacking the cat nature. Everything's just perfect just as it is. Say, no, we have to go on a crusade. The warrior goddess, the viciousness of the warrior goddess, the Virgin Mary warrior goddess, pagan warrior goddess, which was exemplified, or I don't know if that's the right term, which was best, was seen strongly in the Spanish conquests, okay, was totally under the banner of the Virgin Mary. Everywhere they went, they spread her image everywhere. It wasn't about Jesus at all. They didn't spread the image of Jesus at all, actually. It was only the image of the Virgin Mary wherever they went. Conquered like the Philippines too. I mean, and the Philippines just is all about Virgin Mary. It's all about that. There's some token interest in Jesus, but it's the Virgin Mary entirely, really. Wherever the Spanish went, it was all the warrior goddess, Virgin Mary, who, under her banner, we conquest evil. We overcome and conquer evil and plunder it and get all the good for us. We're the pure ones. We're the pure ones. Out to destroy the impure ones. Yeah. This is a fact. We're talking about facts here. And in Hispanic countries, they hardly know Jesus at all. Actually, I've directly experienced this. It's true. It's true. It's shocking. I was just blown away by this. I said, "What are you talking about?" A Christian woman alerted me to this. She says they don't even know Jesus at all. It's totally about the Virgin Mary, and it's a sacrificial cult, I was told by this woman, Christian woman. Helped save my life. It woke me up to it. It's like, hey, she said, hey, brother, be careful what you're involved with here. It's a blood sacrificial cult of killing what's impure, destroying it, and killing it. So, thank you, Christian women. The ones that are listening to Jesus, that is, all right? The ones that really listen to Jesus. Like Marie Watts. Enlightened. She was enlightened. She had the vision of Sambhogakaya, vision of Christ. Marie Watts, here in California. I never met her, but she passed away, I don't know, in the 60s or something. But, I read her books, and it's like, wow. The omnipresence, the allness, all is all. She saw it. She absolutely saw it. And she was working on abiding in it more and more and more and more. She, the true saint, Marie Watts was a true saint, true Christian saint. Is she canonized in the Catholic Church? I don't think so. Yeah, of course, when you believe in matter, you're dissatisfied because you're not experiencing the isness of now. So, what do you want? You want gold, you want silver, you want material goods, you want plunder, you want conquest, you want more and more things. You want materialism. Trying to fill that emptiness, the void within you. Denial of God. You're trying to fill that denial of God with things. So you keep plundering and plundering. I mean, look what the Spanish did. They just, wherever they went, they just plundered, pillaged and raped and plundered and just took everything for themselves. Under the banner of the Virgin Mary, under the banner of pure matter, righteousness. Insanity. So they could gild all their churches, houses of materialism, believing in matter, worshiping the God, the goddess of matter, which is really worshiping nothing at all. So we need to make our churches more ornate, more gold, more gold. They asked Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, we want you to help us build temples. We want to build this temple in your honor. We want to build this hospital. We want to build, 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 build. We want to fill it with golden idols and gold, more gold. And she said, I have no interest in that whatsoever. She says, we got too many temples, too many buildings, too many places, too much stuff already, she says. We don't need any more. All I want from you is just simple practice, just in your home, in a humble, simple way. Just turn your attention to the isness, okay? Beyond good and bad consciousness. Just turn your attention to the isness. That's all I'm asking of you. Very simple. No, she would have none of it. And they tried to get the women. She was surrounded by these women that said, well, we women are more pure, the men. We need to purify the men. And she pointed out that in this realm of delusion, that women are more disciplined and are have the upper hand over men, actually. She said that she said, this is true. This is what I notice. She was just completely objective and just noticed that women are very determined and disciplined in terms of matter, of trying to purify matter. Which is was true. The feminine it does have the upper hand by far here in terms of getting what they want, which is worshiping of matter. But they tried to prevent her from dealing with men, and she always gave them the slip. She said, "No, no, no, no. I'm going to witness to them too." But they really tried to block her from that because they didn't want men to realize, that. the delusion of matter. They wanted men to keep building temples and staffing temples to matter, to duality. See, men are really enslaved in this world by the feminine, with the belief in matter, which is has the symbology is deep down. It's feminine. It's mother based. Yeah, so they think that they're, you know, they spiritualize it, and so they think that doing all these buildings of churches and temples and all that stuff is worshiping the Virgin Mary, the goddess, and God is pleased by this, and this leads to God and all this stuff. But it's not true. It's not true at all. They're just slaves. It's better to just sit wherever you are, peacefully, like I'm doing right now. Just have this little meditation area, humble, simple. A little cot, a little chair, a little bench, which is all I have. And see through all this nonsense and become familiar with isness. And practice the presence, the Christ presence, the Christ consciousness, which is the isness consciousness, which is pure consciousness. But not, even the term pure is not right, which is just isness. There's no pure and impure isness at all. It's like, there's not a pure now and an impure now. Not at all. It just practice the presence, just presence, now presence of the Sambhogakaya bliss body. If you want to attach a name to it, you can. You can say, call it Ramana Maharshi if you want, or Longchenpa, or Jesus, or Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. You can use a, you know, name like that, but you don't have to attach a name, really. They are just very loosely affiliated. It's not central at all. It's not central. It's not like you're trying to get something from it. The presence is it. That's it. As Ramaharshi said, you are just the pristine presence. That's it. Just drop your thoughts, and what's left is pristineness. That's what you are. He says it's that simple. Nothing more to it than that. Drop your crusade. And you will realize you are just pristineness, and that's what we are. That's all it is, just this pristineness, absolute pristineness. With no thought of non-pristineness at all. It can't exist at all. And there's nothing it needs to do to defend itself against non-pristineness, because it doesn't exist, it can't exist. So there's no threat. Reality is not threatened at all. What is real can never be threatened, and what is unreal doesn't exist. So what are we defending? What is unreal is what we're defending. We're defending what doesn't exist, which is folly, isn't it? I don't know what Longchenpa will do. This is just a way of focusing your attention on grace. These Dharma kings are just a way of focusing our attention on the grace of God, really, which is this pristineness, pristine presence. But even that gives the notion of impure presence. No, it's just the presence, the isness presence. Inherently, spontaneously pristine isness presence. Without any other presence. There's only isness without any other isness. There's not two isnesses. There's not a mother of isness. Okay? There's not a mother of isness. There's not an isness of isness. Is. There's not an isness of isness. There's just isness. There's just, that's all. That's it. And so it's not easy for us. We keep slipping back into, okay, here's the purity, but where's the impurity? And no, it's not purity. It's beyond purity. As soon as we start putting it into concepts, then automatically the opposite arises, right? So it's wordless. purity. It's concept-free purity. It's purity from all concepts of purity. Let's put it that way. Let's just experience this presence, this purity, which is completely free of any concept or notion of purity. It's bliss that's completely free of all concepts or notions of bliss. It's inherently free. Its isness inherently free of, quote-unquote, isness. Any concept, any notion of isness. It's unnotioned isness. Unconceptualized isness. Non-conceptualized isness. It's non-imagined isness. It's unseen isness. Non-existent isness. You know, whatever you want to put it. You can practice saying it's the isness of isness. Even there's no precursor. It's a slightly different way of looking at it. But we're just trying to free ourselves from any belief in isness. It's the unbelievable isness. Yes, the unbelievable isness. That's a good way of putting it, isn't it? This is the unbelievable isness. Isness that is simply unbelievable. This is the unbelievable isness. And experience this unbelievable isness. It's the unbelievable presence. Cannot be believed in. Can only be experienced. As soon as we go into belief, we don't experience it anymore. Abidance is the unbelievable abidance. This is what it is. It's completely unbelievable. Reality is totally unbelievable. Cannot be believed. As soon as we're in belief, we're in perception. We're in delusion, actually. Arrogance. So, experience the unbelievable experience. The unbelievable belief. The unbelievable isness. Have gratitude for unbelievability, for your ability to experience the unbelievable. We have unbelievability. Ability. I am unbelievability. Say that. I am unbelievability. The ability to go beyond that, to experience that which is unbelievable. Totally unbelievable. I have unbelievability. I am unbelievability. I am unbelievability. Say that. Ultimately, we're saying I am healed perception. Jesus said that's as far as we can go. As we still have a presence here in this world, that's as far as we can go. He said it. He says, absolutely. But he said, that's far enough. He says, it's absolutely far enough. I have no worries about that. I am unbelievability. How about that? Wow. Talk about something that maybe has not been said here very often. This is it. I am unbelievability. So this is I'm getting to new formulations here, right? This is very intensive, very helpful. I can feel it. I'm aware of it. Wow, I am unbelievability. Just the wow that unbelievability that I am unbelievability, and that's totally unbelievable, isn't it? Yeah, I am unbelievability. Wow. Maybe this is the miracle of Longchenpa I asked for today. Because this is a miracle to look at it this way, in a positive light. Very wowish. So just feel the wow. Just enjoy it. Enjoy the wow. Enjoy the unbelievability we have. The unbelievable isness. The unbelievable nowness. Let's just hang out by a pool in the desert, okay? And just let the pool represent this peaceful, unbelievable peacefulness. Everything is perfect just as it is. The pool is just sitting there, pool of water, just like that blissed out cat. It's just, everything is perfect. The pool is not needy. The pool of water is not needy, is it? Unbelievable perfection. And I just, I am this unbelievability. I am totally unbelievable. I am totally unbelievable. And practice this. What's wrong with that? See, it's about you. It's about your practice. You are totally unbelievable. I am totally believable. We are all totally unbelievable. This is a fact. This is fact. This helps us drop the concept of matter entirely, doesn't it? We stay at a beautiful hotel, maybe, where there's a restaurant, the food is there. We sit around the pool. Now, it's going to be hot in the summer, but maybe, you know, we start early in the morning, like at 5:30 in the morning, and for 4 hours, we just abide in, I am totally unbelievable. I just, wow, this. Then we go into the AC and practice some more. Drive around, enjoy the beauty. Right? Yeah, this is unbelievably beautiful. This is unbelievably beautiful. Everything is unbelievably beautiful. Wordlessly beautiful. Absolutely wordlessly, indescribably, unbelievably beautiful. This is the whole point of it. Unbelievably beautiful. Indescribably beautiful. I am indescribably beautiful. All is indescribably beautiful. All is unbelievably beautiful. Cannot be believed. Cannot be described. Cannot be believed. But describability, that's a slippery slope. I like the belief thing. Unbelievable. I am unbelievability. I am unbelievability. I am indescribability. Put it that way. I am indescribability. You want to go on a trip, drive around Coachella Valley in the summertime. Okay, I'm telling you. There's nobody there. And yet, all the beauty of there, the landscaping and everything, is just stunning. The colors, the contrast, the heat, but all the colors are still blooming in summer. And it's just like, you just drive around and just go, wow. And you can like pull to the side of the road to stop. There's nobody pressuring from behind. There's nobody's in a hurry because it's 113 degrees. And so you're expected to be slow. You walk slow. You do everything slow. You just no hurry. If you want to stop, you just stop. Nobody's going to ask you why you stopped. Everybody's just in slow motion. Everything's in slow motion. And the vibrancy in the heat. You feel the vibrancy. And there's pools of water everywhere. And they're just sitting there. Just basking. And you feel like, just let everything be. Everything's perfect just the way it is. I don't want to work to change anything. That's another. It's too hot to work. I don't want to work to change anything. I'm just happy that everything the way everything is. That's helpful. Very helpful. In fact, I'm happy just where I am. Because why? It's too hot to move. I don't want to go anywhere. Let me just sit here. Oh, it's just perfect right here. So it gives you this feeling. Everything's just perfect. Where I am is perfect. Because you don't want to make any efforts to change anything. It's too hot. But this helps spiritually. It helps. It really does. I am unbelievability. I am unbelievability. Wow. That is a very potent meditation. Opens the door to the Sambhogakaya, Christ consciousness body, subtle body, the vision of Christ. I am unbelievability. I say that a lot. How was the round of golf? I was unbelievable. It was just absolutely unbelievable. Yeah, you get this feeling. It's just unbelievable here. But I'm experiencing unbelievability. I am unbelievability. That's why. I can go somewhere and just feel this is just unbelievable. And others will, you know, where's my food? Where's my this? I feel I'm losing this. Oh, I'm going to get hurt. I'm just like blissed out. Like, it's just, I am unbelievability. This is unbelievable. I'm experiencing my unbelievability here. Wow. Wow. If it gets too hot, we'll take the tram up to 7,000 feet or whatever it is. And, maybe it's 80 degrees up there. Beautiful. And then look out over massive spaciousness. Hike among the pines. Just like, yeah, this is unbelievable. I am unbelievability. But we can practice this right here, right now, where we are. One of the most amazing experiences is just to be in a spot where you feel nobody's trying to get you to move or interact or do anything. You're just free to just experience the unbelievability, your own unbelievability. It's very rare, isn't it? There's always somebody on your case, right? Especially with smartphones. But like out on a golf course, it's 115, 113, just baking. There's nobody out there. And maybe there's one person or two. No marshal, I mean, nobody. And there's nobody telling you to move along. So if you want to just stop and just get some ice water, just drink and pour ice, just pour ice over your head, which was fun. You have all these ice cubes, free ice cubes, all these machines that just make ice cubes. Get a bucket, you just like start pouring ice over your head and just let the ice go under your shirt, just, you know, everywhere, just sit there. For 20 minutes, just not even moving. Don't even move. There's nobody that's going to come along and say, what are you doing? Move along. Nothing. And you just think, this is unbelievable. This is so wonderful. This is like reality. Nobody's telling you what you have to experience or not experience. Or how long you can experience it or, you know, whatever. You're just free to experience this. I just want to sit by this lake of water and just sit here. It's so shocking that there's nobody pushing you to move along. Move along now. You've been here long enough. No. Or I can drive where I want, wherever I want to drive. I don't have to follow my golf ball. I hit the golf ball down there and say, well, I feel like going over here. I want to see what's over here. So you drive over there. You drive over there. Just leave the golf ball out on the fairway. I do this. I leave it there. It'll still be there when I want to go there. But I want to, let me go back to the previous hole. You know, and just look, I want to look at that again. Who does that? So I get to this one hole and hit my drive and I say, you know, that previous hole, you know, so beautiful. I'm going to just go drive backwards and go back there and just sit there and just look at it and enjoy it. So I do that and I just leave my ball on the fairway there. And then after 10 or 15 minutes, I drive back, say, okay, that was great. And then I go drive to where my golf was and say, oh, okay, that's still there. Wonderful. Like that. How cool is that? Or if you hit your golf ball, somebody say, I don't feel like going there right now. I'll go somewhere else. Just, okay. Oh, look at this river. I'm going to go creek. I'm going to go just sit there on the bridge. Just say, that's great. Someone comes along and say, hey, I've got a golf ball out there, right there. You know, just go ahead and say, okay. They understand. They think you're just cooling off, which you are. You're in the shade. You just need to cool off in the shade. Or just for the heck of it, hit your golf ball in the lake on purpose and just watch the ripples. Say, okay, let me just sit here and just watch the ripples. That's very nice. Or hit it in the water, let it roll off in the water just for fun. And you got a ball retriever, then you can just retrieve it when you want to. But it gives you an excuse to go on the edge of the water and just, you know, contemplate. I am unbelievability. I am unbelievability. Now, this dog in this dream I had is designed to kill cats. It's a nasty dog. But this cat in the dream, my cat, this bliss cat, it flipped the script on the dog. It was the dog that was trapped. And I said, that's unbelievable. Yeah, now I know. The cat was letting me know. Yeah, I am that. I am unbelievability. I am unbelievability. Wow. Longchenpa comes through again, which is the grace of God, of course. I asked him for some protection. Yesterday, today I pray in protection, but I am unbelievability. This is a very potent protection. And you see how easy it is? We're not like wrapping sheets of water, sheet blankets, or wet blankets around us, sitting by some ice stream in the top of the Himalayas, freezing, trying. Now we're just sitting here, you know, wherever we are, and we're saying, I am unbelievability. How simple it is, right? He's not saying, oh, you need to, you know, walk, you know, live 2 years on berries and hike the Himalayas and live in caves and do all this, you know, all this Vajrayana stuff. And no, he says, just say, I am unbelievability. That's, yeah. That's super potent, super positivity, super flipping the script. So all praise and thanks to the Dharma Kings, Dharma King Longchenpa, all praise and gratitude to the grace of God, to the Holy Spirit, which is behind it all, right? Ultimately, it's the grace of God. And since our goal is healed perception, it helps us to have some focus like a Dharma King. Some focus like that, it helps. So, the Sambhogakaya, the Christ consciousness, is not totally formless. It still seems to we still seem to be perceiving it, even though we're knowing it and feeling it. There's still also a perceptual component to it, even though it's inward perception. So, all praise and thanks to the Dharma King Longchenpa for being fabulous in answering our prayers. Unbelievability. He has unbelievability, does he not? And he's sharing that unbelievability with us and saying, you are also have unbelievability. So say, I am unbelievability. Unbelievability. The ability to go beyond belief. I am that unbelievability. I am unbelievability. He's sharing that with us. He showed it to me yesterday. He said, I am that unbelievability. Or was it the day before? I am unbelievability. Here it is. I say, wow. That is so sublime. It's unbelievability. Wow. Time is passing so fast. I don't even know how long I've been here. I've been so absorbed in this, really absorbed in it. I am unbelievable absorbability. I am unbelievable absorbability. I am unbelievable saturability, saturability, ability of saturation, of absorbability, unbelievable absorbability. Unbelievable creativeness. I'm unbelievable creativity. Unbelievable creativity. I am unbelievability. Unbelievability. So, ask and ye shall receive. Now, the ultimate gratitude towards the Dharma Kings is practice. We also feel gratitude, just pure gratitude, unbelievable gratitude. But along with that, practicing, actually saying, you know, feeling, I am this, I am unbelievability, and accepting this, absorbing it. Accept it. Wow it. It is acceptance. Wow it. Don't think it. Wow it. So we have powerful, simple tools. Just like building a house, they use simple tools, really. I mean, you got a skill saw and, you know, nail gun. They're simple tools, but you could build anything with those tools. We have simple tools. Just wow it. You know, I am unbelievability. And just wow it. Don't think it. Wow it. Just wow it. How about that? I put these landscapes together. I know a lot of you like that. What, sudden Himalayan enlightenment. The landscapes are continuously fading and melding into, morphing into other landscapes. It's continuous morph going on. It's very profound. It's helping us get to unbelievability. It's like, wow, this is so unbelievable. It's just this continuous, beautiful morphing in the background. Longchenpa is there in the Nirmanakaya mode with the Sambhogakaya bliss presence. Grounded in the Dharmakaya of formlessness. And he's helping us focus our attention, peripheral attention, overall total attention on this morphability, this pure perfect morphability, which is helping us, this unbelievability. Nothing is really fixated at all in our experiencing. Now, we can have the same ornamentation for as long as we want, but it's not fixated. It's never fixated. So we're practicing this non-fixation. It's beautiful. It's unbelievable. Unbelievability. Unbelievable beauty. Unbelievability here of this. And so this helps us. This really helps us. So I'm trying to morph. I'm doing this morphing of flowers also at Longchenpa. It's this morphing. This is very helpful practice. And the proof is in the pudding. How I've gotten, been able to get to this vision, inner vision, the Sambhogakaya bliss body, and this unbelievability. I am unbelievability. So it's working. It's working. So watch the videos. These videos, I try to make them very profound and very helpful. And here's a hummingbird right here. Nice. Ah, it took a seat. Nice. Hello, hummingbird. Now it's down right here. Right in front of me now. Right in front of me. Just hovering. That's sort of an unbelievability right there. Maybe the hummingbird symbolizes, oh, hello. Right in front of me. Unbelievability. It's just hanging out right now. Just moving around right in front of me. Just showing, putting on a display of unbelievability for me. Wow. So wow it. Just wow it. Really, I love hummingbirds. They're so awesome. They're so unbelievable, aren't they? Sometimes they come up right in my face and just hover right there, right in front of me. Just showing me. Look at this unbelievability. There it is again. I just stopped. I am unbelievability. Just wow that. Wow it. Just wow it. Now, the only trouble is going back into the world from this, right? This intensive here. And we can thank space of allowance for saying yes to the intensive, which helps then motivate me to keep doing it. It's difficult if there's nobody saying, okay, yeah, I want to do this, then it's difficult because you feel like you're kind of trying to force it on people. But all you need is one, is to say, yeah, I'll do it. I can relate to this. I can feel it. I can wow it. I can wow this. I can wow this. I want to wow this. People at Carmel Beach, Ocean Beach in Carmel, they go down to watch the sunset on certain days when it's clear, and then especially in spring, the sun sits directly over, directly. So all these people just came down just to watch sunset. Well, they're just standing there. They're just sitting there, staying there pretty quietly, you know, just watching it. Some are just wowing it. Nobody needs to say anything because everyone knows what's going on. Yeah, wow, sunset, beautiful sunset. You don't come around and say, hey, what's going on here? Oh, really? The sun is setting? Well, what time is the sunset? What time does it go down? Oh, did it go down yesterday? It was a little earlier, later? I'm not really sure. No, what is it better in summer? You know, this is avoidance of wowing it. This is thinking it. This is interrogating it. Don't interrogate the wow. This is the ego. This is the belief in matter. This is thinking. There's obstructing. Very, very bad habit. And you say, not now, later, we'll if you need to deal with all those questions, it's not important. All we're here is wowing it, and we have plenty here to wow it. We've got plenty to wow, so that's all we need. Just to practice. This is a good way to practice, to wow. So if you want to practice, practice. If you don't want to practice, don't practice. But just don't bother us with your non-practicing. Don't advocate non-practice to us. We don't want that. That's what I get. Yeah, this is what happens. Trivia stuff of asking questions, whatever trivia come to mind. Is it always like this? Or how do you rate this sunset on a scale of 1 to 10? You know, how long do you think it takes before it sets? Or what's it look like when it's, you know, bombarding you and pestering you with matter-based questions instead of, hey, let's just use this to wow my unbelievability. Or, you know, what's the name of the, if you're in a beautiful area, what's the name of that tree? I can't remember. Someone told me I forgot the name of the tree. Then if you tell them, a little later, I forgot the name of that tree. What's the name of that tree again? Or what's the name of those grass? How often do you think they mow the lawn here? Gee, I wonder how much fertilizer they put on. Just on and on and on. Avoiding the wow. It's called avoiding the wow. And most people are extremely skillful at that, avoiding the wow. This is what they do. Gossiping, talking. You see this place like this is perfect for practicing the wow. For let me wow this. Yeah, there's like, my nails, you know, it's like, let me see, something's not quite right there, my nail, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, something, blah, 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 talking about, oh, yeah, she got this thing, there's it, oh, but somebody's bothering her, oh, the dog, yeah, our dog, well, I had the dog, he's causing some problem here, but I wonder how you take care of the dog like this, talking about animals, and completely avoiding the wowing this, just wow it, this is what we do, we just wow it, I am, unbelievability, just wow this. Just wow it. Remember, the belief in immateriality is always a crusade. It has to be. It has to market itself as pure and impure. Good and bad. It has to market itself that way. Otherwise, it would be obvious that this scam of it all, right? This doesn't satisfy me. Oh. Well, that's because the matter doesn't exist. Instead, we say, no, it doesn't satisfy me because there's impure matter. I need to conquer that. And conquest that, and get all the good stuff, and then I'll be happy. So, this is the hell. It's hell. It's hell. Belief in matter is the belief in hell. Putting yourself in believing that hell is necessary for you, for any for us. It's just. Again, super hot areas. It helps just, it's too hot. I don't feel like, doing anything. I don't even feel like talking. I'm just sitting here. They say, oh, okay, you're hot. I got heat straw. I got overheated. I kind of feel overheated. I don't want to feel like talking. Oh, okay. They leave you alone. And you just wow everything. I feel like in the Coachella Valley, there's opportunities. I feel like I'm able to wow the situation way better there than like the Silicon Valley. It's like, it's almost precluded here. It's a terrible place here, Silicon Valley. Because there it's okay to just stand in the shade and do nothing. Nobody asks you, why are you just standing there in the shade doing nothing? Because it's hot out there. I don't feel like going out in the sun. There's a nice spot here, and everyone gets it. They get it. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a nice place. It's just kind of like that live and let live. Live and let live. Live and let live. Let everything be as it is. There's way more of that ambience there, especially when it's hot. I love it when it's hot there because there's the allowance for just to wow everything. And I just go around with a video camera, wherever, and just wow, 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 wow. Nobody says a word. But you don't get any vibe like, hey, what are you doing? You just don't get it. It doesn't happen, really. I feel like hanging out at the pool. Yeah. No one's going to say, what are you doing hanging out at the pool? I just wow and everything. Yeah. Oh, gosh, it's terrific. It's so wonderful. It's like nirvana almost. You just I can wow this. I can wow that. I can wow. I don't have to think. I can just wow it. I am unbelievability. And the Silicon Valley is such hell. It is such hell here. It is so hellish here. You feel like you can't wow anything. I'm driving by the Apple new corporate headquarters, and you're starting to be able to see it now. The glass is going on, and it's reached the top of, you know, the top level. It's got 5 underground levels to it, but it's got, like, I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 above ground levels. And you can see through the entrance where the truck's driving. You can look and see, and you can start to see it like the spaceships. Wow. I was thinking, maybe I should take some pictures. The idea came. Let me take some video. Let me stop and or drive by. Let me take some video and show you. And immediately, I got this intense feeling of threat. Now, some policeman is going to say, no, you can't do that. Or some security saying, what are you doing? I'm going to confiscate your camera. And I got this whole feeling of hostility towards it. Just the thought of taking a picture of the Apple construction. Immediately, this whole hostility complex. And it's just like, whoa. No. I'm not gonna do it. So I just drove right past. I'm not gonna do that. This is the vibe here. Because Apple is just like insanely secretive of everything they do. And you know, so this whole paranoia here, Silicon Valley, very paranoid place, is terrible. What are you doing here? You know, security everywhere. No, you can't come here, you know, authorized people only, because they're trying to protect all their secrets. You know, all these companies have all these secrets, and of course there's constant espionage going on to steal the secrets. But just, you can't even feel like a normal person. Say, oh, I take a picture of the building. Nobody's doing it. I've not seen one person in the entire construction process ever take a picture there or even stop and look. Nobody, because everybody feels it's taboo. Don't you dare mess with Apple's paranoia. You know, so I said, heck with that, I don't want to publicize Apple anyway, so I'm not going to even stop or even take a picture. I don't want to get my nerves all jangled like somebody's going to come running up. I'm sure they probably have people watching, making sure nobody, you know, even takes a picture of it. Really, it's just but what, you know, what a terrible atmosphere, right? What a terrible atmosphere it is here, and everybody pushing you from behind. No matter how fast you go, they're pushing you even more. Wow, it's just awful here. I want out so badly. It's like the black hole of Calcutta for me. It really is. Every day my nerves are just shaking. Because I want to wow everything. And it's taboo here. You immediately feel guilty, like you're wrong. Like you're doing something really wrong. That's anti-social. Anti-progress. Anti-crusade. You're an anti-crusader. You know. Apple's a total crusader. All these companies are insanely zealous, fanatical crusaders. It's like, man, I don't want to live in a crusader culture. They're crusading to purify, you know, matter. We're making it better. We're making the script better. That's how we purifying impurity by scripting it all just right. They're again fanatical crusaders. And who wants to live in that culture? I sure don't. Sri Sri Nanamaya, what she moved all about, what'd she do? She just sit quietly without saying anything. And people would come from all over just to sit quietly. And she's just basically saying, wow, this, you know, wow, this. This is the Nirmanakaya, the Samogakaya here. Something, you know, just wow it. And if, for, you know, some big beginners or those who need to do something, think that the crusaders saw the crusaderness that we all do here to some extent, say, well, just say, you know, do Sankirtana, Haribo, Haribo, you know, Haribo, Haribo. She'd lead them in some sort of, you know, call and response, focus on spiritual unbelievability. But oftentimes you just sit quietly, just absolute quiet, just total blissful stillness, and give people an opportunity, give us opportunity just to wow it. And say, I am that unbelievability. I am unbelievability. Wow it. Yeah, that's what she did. Look at Ram Maharshi. That's what he did his whole life, right? Just wow this. Wow this. Don't talk about it. Wow this. I haven't eaten anything today. What time is it? It's like 1 o'clock. Yeah. But I don't, it doesn't matter. I don't seem to lose weight even if I don't eat anything. So what's the danger of not eating? Not much. I don't get an ulcer from not eating. So we only have to see what is. It's what it already is. That's it. It's already that way. Nothing we need to do to make it that way. We don't need to change the world. We don't need to do anything to the world. There's nothing we need to do first, right? It's already this way. What is already present. We just need to get used to this, just wowing it. I am unbelievability. We do need to wow it and practice it. It's not just non-dual rhetoric here. We need to really recognize that there is a way to ease into abidance. And the more we practice, the closer we get to it. Whether we get it this lifetime or not, we're laying down fantastically good, great habits. Unbelievably great habits. So keep laying those habits down. Keep practicing these unbelievably great habits. We don't have a time frame where we'll be in abidance. I know there's troubles coming in the world, but I cannot lay a time frame on myself as far as abidance, when I will be in abidance. And I won't do that. I just keep trying to go, as fast as possible. So I advise just go as fast as possible right now. But don't burden yourself with, I have to be in abidance by this date or something. I would say, we need to protect our mind by some date. And we already have it. I am unbelievability. So we already have it. Longchenpa gave it to us. And of course, it's saying Longchenpa gave it to us. They all gave it to us because all of them work as one. It's all collaborative effort here. But I find Longchenpa he's Johnny on the spot, the man of the hour, the Dharma king of the hour, so to speak. He really is fully deserving of that. Somehow he's galvanizing this abidance. The absolute master of abidance, as all Dharma kings are here, all of our four, absolute master of abidance. Perfect skillful meansness of this. People might say, who is this? I don't know, but he sure is helpful. And that's a great way right now to look at it. I don't know, but super helpful, super grace, super miraculous, great. I'll just wow it. I don't even read about his life much. I don't care. It's the only thing that matters to me is he showed up and he's bringing the grace. He's got the grace. There's a book, The Life of Longchenpa, but I haven't ordered it. I haven't read it. I don't really want to know. It doesn't matter to me. That's just more baggage, right? I don't need the baggage. I don't care. I asked for help. He showed up, plain and simple. A friend in need is a friend indeed. He showed up. He gave the empowerment of experience of pure spaciousness right off the bat, immediately. Saying, this is what I'm going to bring you to. This is how I'm going to help. And I said, yeah, that's exactly what we need. So he showed me what the help he showed me right up front the help that he's bringing, which is the experiencing, the abidance in the sky-like nature of our mind, the pure spaciousness. That's what he's going to bring for us. This is the help he's bringing for us. That's exactly what we need. Exactly what we need. Exactly what we need. the other stuff, it could get too heavy, you know. The devotion could get too heavy. There's a lot of stuff that could get too heavy in the world. It's but this, the realization of the sky-like nature of our mind, that there's nothing that's heavy at all. You know, it's just abide in that. Just wow that. So, right up front, immediately, he said, "This is what I'm about. This is what I'm going to bring. This is how I'm going to help you." And I said, "Wow, okay, that, yeah, let's do this." And for me, this is the best way. Now that others have, you know, slightly different ways to help out, different emphasis maybe. But for me, this is what's going to work. I know it. There's no sense of heaviness at all. No sense of gravity-ness at all. It's just all unbelievability. Pure unbelievability. Just pure unbelievability. Pristine unbelievability. I am pristine unbelievability. And again, we all have unique, we've all had unique defensiveness. This is all unique, slightly unique to everyone. And so some works better, some ways work better for others who have particular habits of attention. Some people are very social, they want to do it in a relationship stuff. So Jesus, A Course in Miracles, helps them out, seems to be helping out in that way. Although it helps out in all ways, in my opinion. It's multifaceted. It's helped me out extraordinarily. Journey Beyond Words, so extraordinarily helpful. But Jesus tends to emphasize that in relationship. Where for me, I'm not that way. I tend to have a long history of like being like a hermit. Or very, very focused on creativity. I haven't socialized a lot, really. I don't put any emphasis on socialization. It's not important to me, really. For me, it's all about the wow and silence. So Longchenpa's, you know, pure spaciousness, this approach is very ideally suited for me. If I'm with somebody, instead of talking so much, let's just sit, wow. Yeah. Let's just wow this moment. Let's just wow this where we're at. Just wow this. I can chat a little bit. I'm perfectly able to, but it quickly devolves. You know, when you talk with people, I find it very quickly starts going down into matter worshiping. Just like that. Words tend to lend themselves to that. You got to be very careful. It's very difficult to keep a conversation like at where it needs to be. Extremely difficult, which is why I don't converse. These videos are not, these are a conversation, but it's a sharing of let's wow this, you know. It's a sharing of it. I'm not getting a back and forthness. I'm aware of what people might be thinking or feeling, so I address that in what I say. But it's a real skill. It's a real talent to be able to do this. And most people simply can't. They can't. They cannot keep it. It's just not possible. It gets heavy. It gets heavy. It feels matter. It feels matter gets into it. Script gets into it. It's way better to just wow it. And some have this, you know, the heart approach, loving heart approach or devotion approach, and they just want to relate with other people, you know, in a heartfelt way and hug each other and say, "Oh, you're so wonderful, you're so wonderful too," and there's, "Oh yeah." Okay, that's their approach. I'm not, you know, so comfortable, I'm not as comfortable with that approach as just the pure spaciousness approach. I get uncomfortable if people try to focus too much on me, you know. It's like, hey, you know, let's just all just abide in the wow of our unbelievability here. And it's not about me. It's not about you. It's about unbelievability, really. Pristine unbelievability. That's what it's really about. It's about bliss. There's just this universal bliss. I am universal, pristine, unbelievable bliss. I am unbelievability. I am pristine unbelievability. I am pristine unbelievability. I'm waiting for my board shorts so I can hang around the pool. I ordered them. Maybe they come in today. Maybe, yeah. Yeah. Maybe today. That's exciting. I've got my pool sandals came 2 days ago. White, all white with stars on them. White, by the way, signifies unbelievability. Pristine unbelievability. Sambhogakaya bliss. Non-scriptedness, complete non-scriptedness. The absence of matter. That's what white represents. That's why I wear white. And the black trim, where I wear black, it represents the pragmatism of practice here. We have to understand that we still have attachments to the belief in matter and scriptedness and stuff. And we're still in the world. So the black trim means, hey, we're still in the world. Let's not forget that. I mean, quote unquote, we're still, okay, you know, there is no world. But we're still functioning around people who believe there is a world. Let's put it that way. We're still dealing with insanity here. Come on. We're still breathing, and the body's still breathing and eating and all that. And so, but the white, no script. Or if there is, like the board shorts I ordered have this sort of like some sort of ancient script written on them, some sort of, it's very abstract script. Okay, let's whatever words we use, let it be very profound, let it be very abstract, let it, you know, let's just wow this. I am pristine unbelievability. Well, those are still words, right? But it's like very, very skillful use of words, right? Very, very helpful use of words like this. It's like words getting out of their own way. So I have some like script on the shorts. I don't know what kind of script it is. Is it Sanskrit or Tibetan or Indonesian or, you know, something that's like very abstract. We don't know what it says, but it's just, okay, let's just wow it. Wow. It's white shorts, black script on white shorts. I really searched for the board shorts, the right ones. When I saw it, it was like immediate bingo. That's it. There's so many different styles. It's difficult shopping for clothes. It's just like I can't find what I really want. Is it? But when you see it, it's, oh, okay, yeah, that's it. again, there is no such thing as matter. Never will be. Dream of matter is a total, just a fantasy. An hallucination, a fantasy. There is no matter. And the fantasy of matter is in the now, right now, is in the unbelievable now. The unbelievable now. Wow, very nice atmosphere right now. Wow. Wow, the atmosphere. Really, really nice. Wow. The atmosphere is smooth. It's both warm and cool. You get sort of alternating bands of warmth and then coolness. It's a mixture, like, but it's still very smooth. Just a little breeze. It's almost like the absence of atmosphere. The unbelievable atmosphere. So, I'm setting an example the best I can of how to be successful, really. On the path, how to really reach our goal of abidance in the pristine unbelievability, that I am pristine unbelievability. Abide in I am pristine unbelievability. And so there's disciplines that help out greatly. Stay away from scriptedness. Stay away from like I said, boycott. I use the term boycott. It's a helpful term. Boycott it. Boycott's a serious thing. You say, I will not, I'm not going there. I simply am not going.